This is BRICS Global Television Network's weekly news roundup. We begin with the headlines. BRICS Plus countries speak out on the attempted assassination of former US President Donald Trump. Google, the owner of YouTube, blocks 200 Russian YouTube channels for allegedly advocating for Russia's war on Ukraine. Saudi Arabia congratulates Iran's newly elected president. And it's all the rage in many countries around the world. Pickleball now officially launches in South Africa. Hello, I'm Juliet Newell. We begin with one of the biggest stories this week, the attempted assassination of former US President Donald Trump. World leaders have spoken out condemning the incident. BRICS Plus members Egypt, South Africa and Brazil have also weighed in, with Egyptian President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi describing the shooting as a treacherous incident. South African President Cyril Ramaphosa says the attempt served as a stark reminder of the dangers of political extremism. And former Brazilian President Jair Bolsonaro has also drawn parallels between the Trump shooting and his own stabbing incident during a 2018 campaign rally, both seen as narrow escapes from death. Bolsonaro, often likened to Trump of the tropics for his far-right views, survived an assassination attempt when stabbed in the abdomen during his campaign. Reflecting on Trump's recent close call where a bullet grazed his ear, Bolsonaro remarked in a video on the X social network, "He was saved, in my opinion, as I was." In contrast, Brazil's leftist president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, condemned the attack on Trump, urging solidarity in defending democracy amid political turmoil reminiscent of the United States. In South Africa, President Cyril Ramaphosa, addressing parliament after his African National Congress party lost its absolute majority for the first time in recent elections, has pledged his government of national unity to prioritize growth, job creation and poverty reduction. Alongside tackling high living costs and bureaucratic inefficiencies, he emphasized inclusive economic development.
"We are committed to improve the well-being of our country and its people through inclusive growth, the creation of jobs, and the reduction of poverty. The Government of National Unity has resolved to dedicate the next 5 years to actions that will advance three strategic priorities. Firstly, to drive inclusive growth and job creation. Secondly, to reduce poverty and tackle the high cost of living. And thirdly, to build a capable, ethical, and developmental state. We have decided to place inclusive economic growth at the center of the work of the Government of National Unity and at the top of our national agenda. We are determined that growth must be inclusive and that growth must also be transformational. Inclusive growth must drive the redistribution of wealth as well as opportunity. It must support the empowerment of Black South Africans and women and all those who in the past had been relegated to the fringes of our nation's economy. We will forge a new inclusive growth path for South Africa by pursuing a massive investment in infrastructure through a more holistic and integrated approach, positioning Infrastructure South Africa as the central institution of coordination and planning."
After winning only 40% of the vote in May, the ANC joined forces with 9 other parties, marking a shift from its political dominance. Ramaphosa acknowledged public discontent with record unemployment of 33% and high poverty and crime rates. In his address, he promised business-friendly reforms, a crackdown on corruption in public services, and substantial infrastructure investments. He stressed the need for growth that empowers historically marginalized groups such as Black South African and women, aiming to integrate themselves into the economy. Russia's hitting out at Google after around 200 Russian YouTube channels were blocked. YouTube, owned by Google, has restricted access to numerous channels associated with Russian state-funded media and individuals vigorously advocating for Moscow's military actions in Ukraine. Now, Russia reportedly wants to block Google, but have not carried out the threat just yet. There is speculation about whether Russian authorities will completely block YouTube, one of the country's most widely used media platforms, amidst increased pressure on US technology firms and media organizations. It's understood the country's communications regulator, Roskomnadzor, has written to Google CEO Sundar Pichai saying, unblock more than 200 channels of media outlets, government bodies, sport, clubs and political and artistic personalities that have supported the policies of Russia. Moscow's banned numerous Western media outlets and tightened its grip on the internet during its military operations. In 2022, Russia classified Facebook and Meta, which owns Instagram, as extremist organizations. Last week, a Russian mobile operator, Rostelecom, said that speeds on YouTube had slowed down. The rumor mill kicked into gear with claims that authorities were behind the move, but the Kremlin said it was due to problems with Google's technical equipment. China and Russia have held joint naval exercises this week, highlighting strengthened cooperation and trust between the two allies as heightened tensions with Western powers persist. The drills, known as Joint Sea 2024, were conducted off the coast of Zhangjiang in China's Guangdong province, encompassing the disputed South China Sea region. The Chinese Navy confirmed completion of all scheduled activities involving seven warships aimed at enhancing maritime security responsibilities. The drills come despite NATO's criticism and accusation of China's support of Russia's military activities. China's reiterated its neutrality in Ukraine's conflict while deepening diplomatic and military ties with Russia, emphasizing their enduring partnership despite historical complexities. Saudi Arabia's Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman reached out to congratulate Iran's newly elected president Masoud Pezeshkian following July elections. Both leaders acknowledged the progress in bilateral relations and emphasized the importance of further cooperation across various sectors. King Salman bin Abdulaziz has previously sent his own congratulatory messages to Pezeshkian shortly after his election in early July, expressing optimism for the continued enhancement of ties between the two nations and peoples. Relations between Sunni-majority Saudi Arabia and Shiite-dominated Iran had been strained for 7 years before recent efforts at reconciliation, facilitated by a China-brokered agreement in March last year. Diplomatic exchanges, including the exchange of ambassadors and ministerial visits, have signaled a thaw despite differing stances in conflicts, including those in Syria and Yemen. In the United Arab Emirates, Dubai's ruler Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum has appointed his son, Sheikh Hamdan bin Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, as the UAE's defense minister in a cabinet reshuffle. Sheikh Mohammed, also the UAE's prime minister, revealed the appointment on X, noting Sheikh Hamdan's new role alongside his existing position as deputy prime minister. Sheikh Hamdan, 41 years old, has served as Dubai's crown prince since 2008. And graduated from the UK Sandhurst Military College in 2001. The UAE, a significant global player and ally to major powers, continues to wield influence in the Middle East as a leading oil producer. In Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, earlier this week, thousands of policemen carried out an operation on 10 favelas in Rio de Janeiro aimed at cracking down on escalating conflicts between drug traffickers and militias. Around 2,000 officers pounced on the slums armed with assault rifles at dawn. Their first task was to break down cement barricades erected by criminals to control movement and access to the area. No area is off limits to public authorities. We are committed to restoring order, stated Rio State Governor Claudio Castro during a press briefing. Governor Castro later confirmed the initial arrests of 20 individuals at the onset of the operation, which proceeded without any reported clashes. However, concerns about potential leaks preceding the operation were raised. Security remains a pivotal concern, particularly with Brazil's upcoming local elections in October, encompassing nearly 6,000 municipalities, including Rio. Police raids are frequent in favelas, vibrant yet troubled communities plagued by high insecurity due to drug traffickers and paramilitary militias. In India, a passenger rail derailment near Ayodhya has resulted in 2 deaths and injured 24 others. The Chandigarh-Dibrugarh Express, a 22-car service covering 2,640 kilometres, overturned near Gondar district around 2:30 p.m. on Thursday. Indian Railway spokesperson Pankaj Kumar Singh confirmed the fatalities, with 24 individuals receiving treatment at nearby hospitals. Some of them are in critical condition. Rescue operations are ongoing, with footage showing overturned compartments and passengers atop wreckages. Uttar Pradesh's Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath expressed condolences and directed urgent relief efforts. India, despite ongoing modernization efforts, grapples with railway safety issues, averaging 20,000 annual deaths in accidents attributed to infrastructure defects, maintenance gaps, and human error. Coming up, BRICS Plus Business News.
Coming soon on BRICS Global Television.
This blind kid arrives. I get emotional. And he's special needs and he's blind. And they can't talk to him. So I grab him and I put him on the boxing bag and I put the gloves on and I illustrate to him, hit the bag. And just to see this child learn in 1 minute how to let his aggression go, and he loved it. And he was squealing because obviously he was mentally challenged and things like that. Just to see that, sure, it was incredible.
For many, dance in Africa is a rich cultural expression, serving various purposes like entertainment and religious rituals. However, over thousands of years, dance in Africa has been used as a secret way to communicate, sometimes during birth and death, frequently to each other, and at times directly to the gods.
We begin in China, where quarterly sales for Richemont luxury brands products tumbled in the first quarter of this year as the country battles economic difficulty. Richemont, a Switzerland-based luxury goods holding company, was founded by South African businessman Johann Rupert in 1988, whose family still owns a controlling stake in the business, with Johann as chairman. The Swiss luxury group that owns brands including Cartier, Piaget and Chloe has reported overall global sales dropped 1% in the first quarter to $5.74 billion, with significant losses of 19% in the Asia-Pacific region. This, however, does not include Japan, Richemont's highest sales region. China topped the losses with a drop of 27%. The company says the decline reflected both the low level of consumer confidence and the strong comparatives, ranging from double-digit growth in the mainland to triple digits in Hong Kong and Macau over the prior year period. Meanwhile, China's economic growth slowed to 4.7% in the latest quarter ending June, and retail sales growth dipped to 2%. One of the key factors affecting the country's economy is its property market crisis. China's housing crisis reflects broader challenges related to urbanization, economic development, and governance, highlighting the complex interactions between market forces, government policies, and societal needs. And Richemont isn't the only luxury group affected by China's slowdown economy. Swiss watch group Swatch has also reported a sharp drop in demand for luxury goods in China. Meanwhile, youth unemployment in China saw a slight decrease in June, according to official statistics released this week. The National Bureau of Statistics reported that the unemployment rate among individuals aged 16 to 24 dropped to 13.2% last month, showing a slight improvement from May's 14.2%. Excluding students, this is the lowest rate recorded since authorities resumed publishing youth unemployment data in January, using a revised calculation method. In contrast, the unemployment rate for individuals aged 25 to 29 was 6.4% in June. That's down from 6.6% in May. Meanwhile, the overall unemployment rate held steady at 5%, according to the NBS. And since lifting stringent COVID-19 controls over 18 months ago, China's anticipated post-pandemic recovery has been less vigorous than expected. Alongside challenges in the heavily indebted property sector and strained trade relations with West, soaring unemployment has emerged as a significant obstacle. The Trump Organization's revealed it's entered into a partnership with a Saudi developer to construct a high-rise tower in Dubai, a key business hub in the UAE. Known as Trump Tower Dubai, the project targets the luxury market in the city, with details about location and design slated for release by year's end. That's according to Dar Global, the international arm of Saudi firm Dar Al Arkan. The development includes a Trump Hotel and residential units branded under the name Trump. This announcement follows a recent agreement between Dar Global and the Trump Organization for another tower in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. The Trump Organization, managed by Donald Trump's son since 2017, continues to expand its global footprint amid scrutiny over potential conflicts of interest during Trump's presidency. Russian President Vladimir Putin's cautioned against the impact of cryptocurrency mining, expressing concerns about its significant electricity consumption and potential to cause regional power shortages. He noted that cryptocurrency mining already consumes nearly 1.5% of Russia's total electricity usage, with this figure continuing to rise. Putin says there's an urgent need for controlled growth in mining activities to prevent energy deficits, citing existing shortages in Siberian regions. While he did not propose specific measures, Putin stressed the necessity of timely decisions, coinciding with upcoming discussions in Parliament on a bill aimed at regulating cryptocurrency. The legislation includes provisions to restrict large-scale mining to authorized entities and empower the government to impose bans in energy-strained areas. Additionally, Putin urged accelerating efforts to introduce a state-backed digital ruble. Coming up, BRICS Plus Sports News.
Well, here we have it. Time to turn things around. You caught the taxi and watched the money drain out of your account. Now we're going to pay you if you are lucky enough to catch our taxi. Small problem. You've got to know a few things about bricks. No, not the stuff you build your house with. Welcome to the Bricks on Wheels show.
Coming soon on BRICS Global Television.
What was your moment in prison when you were like, I don't want to do this anymore?
I was 21 years old when I took my first life in prison. I had one star on my shoulder. By the age of 25, I became the first star general of the 28s, meaning that I had four stars on both my shoulders. I had taken eight people's lives.
We begin with news from Paris Olympics 2024 taking place in France from later on this month. The first athletes have arrived at one of the Olympic villages. They include Australia and participants from BRICS plus country Brazil. They're settling into a village north of Paris where almost 14,500 people, including 9,000 athletes, will be housed at the peak of the games.
Very excited. It's nice weather to it as well. So looking forward to the next couple of weeks here.
The accommodation features units that are designed to be 6 degrees Celsius lower than the summer temperature outside, which means there are no aircon units. The Olympic Games begins on 26th of July and will conclude on September the 8th. And after that, the units will be converted into homes, a third of which will be used for public housing. And it's all the rage in many countries around the world, though it's been around for quite a long time, its popularity is once again on the rise. Pickleball. And the sport has recently launched officially in South Africa. BGTN correspondent in South Africa, Ben Ricozzo.
Pickleball, a vibrant blend of tennis, badminton and ping pong, has rapidly gained global popularity. And Alon Rock is at the forefront of bringing this excitement to South Africa. With a vision to make pickleball accessible and enjoyable for all people of all ages and backgrounds, Alon has been instrumental in establishing the sport presence throughout strategic partnerships with community centers and sport clubs nationwide. I asked Alon on how he came up with the idea of bringing the pickleball to South Africa.
So this is 2 years in the making. I've been speaking to the German country club for 2 years when pickleball just came on the scene in the country, and they weren't quite interested or ready to talk to us at that point. So I've been chatting to them all along the way with the chairman, Michael Lash, and last year he said, let's talk. We had conversation and he said they actually want pickleball at the club. They think it'll be a great addition to what they have to offer currently.
Okay, 1, 2, 3.
At the launch of pickleball in Sandton, South Africa, Ismail Schuster, Alon Rock's partner in business, spoke passionately about the rapid growth of pickleball in South Africa and how the sport is becoming a favorite pastime across the country.
Anyone can play pickleball. It's easily accessible. It's a low barrier to entry sport. It's fun to play. It's a sport that you don't have to be 100% fit to play, but you can play to get fit, which is quite interesting.
The official launch of pickleball in South Africa marks a significant and exciting milestone in the country's sporting scene. With Alon Rock and Ismail Schuster at the helm, the sport is poised for rapid growth and widespread adoption. The enthusiastic response from the communities, the establishment of new facilities, and the upcoming series of clinics and tournaments signal the bright future for pickleball. Ben Ricozzo, BGTN in Sandton, South Africa.
And that's your sports wrap for this week. We'll be back just after this.
South African townships have had a significant influence on the sound of music. Townships, which were racially segregated areas during apartheid, were hubs of creativity and cultural expression.
You know, I wrote a simple love song, which was called You're So Good to Me. And it suddenly became this enormous hit on Ukhozi FM, which is a Zulu vernacular station. They were state-owned stations in those days. Radio Zulu played isiZulu, Radio Xhosa played isiXhosa. This is how the state divided us. You know, what we heard was divided.
Frankie, you know, what I do is not about me. It doesn't belong to me. I'm the only for it. So if it serves the interests of those who are all over the world, that would be my gift to last.
Radio DJs have historically played a significant role in shaping the music industry and the sound of popular music.
I think bubblegum really found its footing and stuck to the ears of listeners in the 80s.
Coming soon on BRICS Global Television.
I remember being in the stadium, going into the stadium, and then there were kids outside asking for our autograph and things like that. And they really believed that we were these superhuman characters that we just used the wheelchair to get around, hidden superpowers kind of thing. And the stadium in London was sold out every single day. I mean, for that, it I think was both for the athlete and for people around the world said, you know, this is actually something worth watching. This is something, you know, that's worthwhile. We can take note of it.
And finally, in China, a lower birth rate's leaving many preschools empty, and educators have come up with a clever way to repurpose them. The country's aging population is growing, and what better way to use the schools than to convert them into centres for the elderly? This facility in Shaanxi province used to be a school for young children, but as the chairs started to empty, the principal, Li Xiling, needed to come up with a plan. After almost 20 years as a kindergarten, catering for up to 280 children at a time, the facility closed last year due to dwindling numbers. But thanks to the entrepreneurial spirit of Principal Li Xiling, it reopened late last year as a recreational centre for people of retirement age and above. She named it Impressions of Youth. The centre offers music, dance, modelling and other subjects to around 100 adult learners. And for some, it's a chance to fulfil the dreams they had when they were young. And Li Xiling is not the only one flipping her kindergarten. There are several other centres in China who've done the same, transforming preschools into recreational centres for the elderly. Well, that's your BRICS Plus News Roundup for this week. We'll be back again next week with more. In the meantime, check out our website and social media for daily updates.